welcome everyone to the Equal Opportunities Committee, the 14th meeting of 2014. Can I ask everyone to set any electronic devices to flight mode or the off position, please? Today's only agenda item is evidence on the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and we'll start the session with some introductions. At the table, we have our clerking and research team, official reporters and broadcasting services, and around the room, we're also supported by Security Office. And I'd like to also welcome the observers in the public gallery. My name is Margaret McCulloch, and I'm the committee's convener. And I now invite members and witnesses to introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right.
I am Marco Biaggi. I'm the deputy convener. I'm the MSP for Edinburgh Central, and good morning.
Alec Johnston, member for North East Scotland.
Good morning, John Finney, MSP Highlands and Islands.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Good morning, Christian Allard, MSP for the North East of Scotland.
Good morning, Alastair Pringle, Scotland Director of the Equality Human Rights Commission.
Good morning, Chris Oswald, Head of Policy and Communications.
Thank you both for coming along. I'll start asking this first question. It's about your budget. We see that in 2014, your budget 14-15 is £17 million. When the EHRC was established in 2007, it actually had a budget of £70 million. Can I ask how the reduced budget and staffing is actually impacting on the EHRC's ability to fulfil your statutory obligations, for example, the monitoring of the public sector equality duty, please?
Yes, you can indeed. I mean, the last time we gave evidence, which I believe was 2012, we talked in detail really then about the impact of the budget reductions. In fact, at the time, the key reductions were around our grants function and also around our helpline function. So both of those were then removed. The helpline function, I think, as you'll be aware, was moved to a UK provider with Sitel. On top of that, we then faced probably what was considered to be a similar reduction to those of other NDPB-type organisations. We've obviously, since those budget reductions, had to do a significant amount of reorganisation and review of our functions. We do believe that we're now in a more stable place and that we have the staff in place in Scotland and indeed across GB to continue to deliver our statutory functions. What's probably important in relation to all of this is that the budget cuts were based on a review of where statutory functions actually were. So rather than a sort of arbitrary cut to the resources that we have, the review, which was called at the time a core budget review, looked at what was set out in statute, what that actually cost, and that formed the basis of our budget. That was the case for this year, and it will be the same case for next year. So we're actually on a sort of level footing for our budget next year. We have to work differently, obviously. We don't have nearly the number of staff that we have that we had in Scotland. We now have a headcount of 17, which is approximately 14.75 full-time equivalent staff. With three vacancies, which is quite a difference from where we were when the EHRC opened back in 2007. So we have to work more strategically, but we do still place a significant amount of investment and resource, particularly around issues like the monitoring of our public sector equality duty. So all our budget is used for delivering our core functions or our statutory functions. As you're probably also aware, we also then have access to this year in the region of about £8 million, which is a discretionary programme fund from the UK government. So far, we've managed to access in the region of about £3.9 million of that fund to develop a series of programmes which are probably a bit more promotional or proactive around issues like participation in sports. There's a piece of work that's just started around LGBT hate crime reporting, which are probably the sorts of projects that we would have undertaken in the past. So in summary, I would say that we are still able to deliver our statutory functions. We no longer deliver some of the functions that we did when we were first established. The grants function no longer exists at all, but the helpline function is delivered by the Quality Advice and Support Service, and that we work more strategically to deliver what's set out in statute.
Thank you. Mr. Oswald, do you want to say anything, or are you
I think
happy with that?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Mm-hmm. Can I now pass you over to Alex Johnson?
I was just going to ask, having spoken briefly there about budgets and trends, I wondered how that actually matches workload. Do you feel that your workload is continuous and even, or do you feel that a change in workload that is perhaps following a different pattern to budget?
It's difficult to say whether there is a specific trend. One thing that we have noticed around our legal work, we have invested quite significantly in going out and speaking to advice givers and advice agencies and legal firms to continually remind them that we exist and that we're in business looking for strategic cases and strategic referrals, which sits alongside the role of the Quality Advisory and Support Service. And that's definitely paid dividends. 2 years ago, when I joined the Commission, there was certainly a lower number of strategic referrals coming in. And I think that was that there was a mixture of reasons in relation to that. I certainly believe that we are almost at capacity now around the range of strategic cases that we're dealing with in Scotland. In relation to the public sector equality duty, there were a new set of reporting requirements came into play last year, and that again has taken up a significant amount of our staff time. But most of that can be planned for, and most of that we have a level of control over how we plan going forward. So I don't think in this current moment in time there is a flow of work that we're not able to deal with. We are actually able to work fairly flexibly to respond to both the strategic cases that are coming in and their response to working in the public sector equality duty in particular.
I think the last time we had an indication of the number of referrals of potential legal cases that you were getting was back in February 2013, I think, according to my notes here. How many referrals have you had and what's been the trend in referrals since then?
Are you talking across all areas of work?
Well, I'm interested in all areas of work, but I'm also interested in any areas that show particular trends that may differ from them.
Unfortunately, I don't have those figures to hand. And my head of legal, who was here last time, probably would have had those to hand. But I'd be very happy to try and provide a summary of that for you in writing.
Be very grateful. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you very much. Can I now pass you over to John Mason?
Thanks, convener, and good morning. I think the whole area of monitoring compliance with the public sector equality duty, some of the points we picked up on, EHRC found that employee monitoring was patchy and inconsistent across all sectors. Overall performance was poor. Of the 184 public authorities examined, only 27% produced the full set of information on the protected characteristics of their staff. Could you give us any comments as to why you think performance seems to have been poor?
I'm going to hand over to Chris. Chris leads our public sector equality duty monitoring work, and I'll pick up any other points.
We've done a lot of work to assess the performance of public bodies against the public sector duty. Published three reports looking at outcomes and particularly employee monitoring. We are moving into a diagnostic phase, what we're calling a diagnostic phase, working with the Scottish Government to try and get underneath the data. We can see the outcome, which is poor results, as you've highlighted. We need to know why that is. In terms of employee data, we know that there are issues about disclosure, that people may not feel comfortable about disclosing their sexual orientation or their faith or belief. That may be some of the issues. There may also be issues about how data is collected, how it is analysed, how it is moved around inside the organisation. Some of the protected characteristics which are to be monitored. Some have come into play relatively recently, so there are adjustments being made inside public bodies to be able to capture this data, to be able to analyse it. But the situation is not as good as we would have expected, and one of the pieces of work which we're now engaged with the Scottish Government and other partners, is to try and get underneath the skin of the data, find out what the problems are, which are common across all public bodies, to identify where the best practice is and to try and translate that best practice from the good performers to those who are not succeeding at the moment. As I say, so there's a range of factors, some of which are not always in the control of the individual authorities, such as personal decisions about wanting to disclose or being able to disclose. Once we've got under the skin of that, we may be able to then suggest better questions, messaging which can be given to assure employees that the data, the information which they're giving about their own personal characteristics is confidential and will be used for the proper purposes.
Because presumably, I mean, some of the examples you give, like sexual orientation or faith and things, people might not want to, but then you would expect that to be the case in every employer. But I think you're suggesting some employers are actually doing better than others. Is that the case?
I think there are some employers who have a more complete set of data. But when you look across all of the organisations, there are particular deficits in terms of recording around sexual orientation, around gender reassignment. Pregnancy and maternity was one which I think was the lowest one of all, and that was common across all organisations. What we want to do is to identify, what we're in the process of doing is identifying those people who are working best, find out why that is working best, and start to try and transmit or transfer that learning from the best to the ones who are struggling.
Would you like to tell us who some of the best are, or is that not
allowed? We've taken the decision not to, to name and shame, in that we will be... we're not. Simple answer.
It's quite a challenging area. I mean, it's been an issue that the EHRC has been working on for 7-8 years. Having previously worked in the Scottish Government Health Department, I remember receiving letters on in relation to this very issue. And I do think there's... the discussions we've been having with the Scottish Government are around what is it actually we're trying to achieve here. And what we're trying to achieve is that public authorities are able to demonstrate fair employment practices, fair recruitment practices. The way that the specific duties are set out require public bodies to count beans, and that involves large-scale systems. If you look at the NHS, most health boards have their own individual HR systems. There's been talk for a long time about an EHR system that will solve the problem, or another sort of system that will solve the problem. But those systems have never been introduced. So I do think the time is right for us. As Chris says, said there, to diagnose the problem properly rather than just continue to write compliance letters because people aren't counting numbers. Instead, have a more detailed discussion with public authorities about what is getting in the way and how we might resolve what really feels a little bit like an ongoing cycle here.
Kind of optimistic that we're improving and just a wee bit, if we're patient for a bit of time, then we're going to get there, or are you not?
I think we need to do something different. To be honest, I think, I don't have the answer because it's a difficult problem. As I say, I mean, I had responsibility for aspects of this across NHS Scotland, and there is not one answer. There's not one way of turning this around because it covers staff attitudes. It covers societal attitudes. If people are fearful about being their sexual orientation being disclosed, then they're going to be less likely. You know, if they live in an environment where they fear that, they're going to be less likely to tell their employer. There are a whole host of drivers, I think. I don't think it's sufficient just to say you have to have 100% employment monitoring in place by. I think it's important to look at progressive improvement, and we have seen some progressive improvement. Going back to the NHS, when there was an investment in what I think was called the Equality, Diversity and Information Project, which did a fair bit of scrutiny and support work with health boards, we did see some improvement there. But without that sort of continual investment and support, I don't think we've seen the sort of gradual improvements that we would hope to, and I do think our measuring up work showed that quite clearly.
So we met recently with the Scottish Government. They're leading a sort of national programme of work to look at the range of findings from our public sector duty monitoring, looking at employment monitoring, looking at quality outcomes, looking at pay gap issues. I'm trying to think about all this a bit differently because certainly pay gap and equal pay has been an issue for a lot longer than the last 7 years and again isn't going away.
Absolutely. So, I mean, you've mentioned the government specifically, you've mentioned the NHS specifically. Who are the other kind of key players? Is COSLA a player in this, for example?
We're in terms of the improvement work that we're doing.
So who else is kind of on board to push it?
We are currently just developing a group of public bodies and particularly intermediary bodies, so COSLA will be one of those, the NHS, other organisations. If I can maybe just come back to a point of clarification on the employment duty. The previous duties around race, particularly, was an absolute duty. It was, you must collect this data. The current duty is a duty which says you have to take steps to collect that data. So it's a progressive realisation duty rather than an absolute, you must have this done by a fixed date. So we're working towards that, trying to understand what the problems are and assisting organisations to improve rather than simply battering them over the head because they're not able to deliver a full panoply of data.
And also just to add that there is also NGO engagement in this broader programme of work, including organisations like Bridge the Gap. So it is there are a range of players that are already or will be involved and engaged under this national equality piece of work.
So they'd be able to go into a particular employer or sector and kind of help them basically to how they would work it out?
I think the idea is to going back to the diagnosis, but to understand what the problems are, to look at who's doing stuff well, and to look at who are having problems, bring them together, and do some of that information sharing. Another example is around our equality outcomes work, where we've taken the lead. So there are different strands of this work. The HRC took the lead on the equality outcomes piece of work, and again, you'll see. In relation to the number of public authorities who had what we classified as poor equality outcomes, we have worked with the poorest performing, sent out invitations. We've been working with 45 public authorities in detail, working with them to self-assess where we think they need to make improvements. That approach has been very much welcomed. It's not the sort of approach the Commission might have taken in the past, which might have been a compliance note. Instead, we've invested quite a lot of staff time, one-to-one support for public authorities with individual members of staff, bringing them together with those who've performed well. The evaluation for that piece of work will be due in, I think
November.
It's November, December, and the feedback so far is really positive, and we are seeing improvements in outcomes. So I think the approach is right, and we're planning to take the same approach across the other strands of work.
That was 45 you mentioned. I mean, there was also, I noted 27 authorities were subject to further review. Is that the same kind of idea?
Was it 27? Those were situations where there was simply no publication of outcomes, or the publication was so poor that we intervened. The 45 are a group where we felt particularly that the outcomes were not precise enough, or the performance measurements were not clear, so that the organisation wouldn't be able to say at the end of the four-year period meaningfully whether or not they had any progress or not. And that's what we want to focus on, is to make sure that they can demonstrate progress or a lack of progress.
The greatest concern. OK, and my final point then, you've kind of emphasised that the way you're doing it is maybe a little bit different than it was in the past, and it's much more getting alongside people, but ultimately you do have enforcement powers, I think. Could you just spell out a little bit as to what they are?
The range of enforcement powers. Yeah, absolutely. I know this was an issue when we were last here. We do have a range of powers at our disposal, and we tend to focus on trying to be as effective as possible and as strategic as possible. And our end game is always achieving positive change. Some of them can be really resource intensive, and I know that you'll be aware of some of the work that we've done, for instance, our inquiries around disability harassment and human trafficking, where we're looking at sort of societal issues. So that's one power that we can use, and that could take a couple of years to work through, be resource intensive, but lead to quite significant change across a wide range of agencies. We can undertake assessments into using our sort of Section 31 powers of how public authorities are meeting the requirements of the public sector duty. So that's looking across the piece, and we used that particular power in 2011 when we undertook an assessment of the Scottish Government's work around equality impact assessment. And that led to the report Better Policy, Better Lives. So that sort of power would be used if we wanted to look across an organisation's work. We then have, we can intervene in court cases where we believe they touch on issues that relate to our work.
Can you just clarify that? When you say intervene in court cases, is that by supporting...
Normally
giving legal advice.
Yes, normally supporting giving legal advice. The sorts of cases might be the Supreme Court ruling on equal pay in Dumfries and Galloway, where we would offer our support and our expertise around equality law. So it wouldn't necessarily be us taking forward the case, but others are taking forward a case and we can apply to intervene. And there's a range of examples. That's quite a frequent aspect of our work. Another case might be around the Ewedin, Chaplin and the Dell cases, which were around... freedom of thought and conscience and religion in the workplace. So there's a British Airways case and others. I suppose a lot of our work is also around either formal agreements, which are generally confidential in nature. They avoid entering the court. So where we believe an organisation may be behaving in a discriminatory fashion, we can engage and approach them if we think they will be amenable to that and enter into a confidential agreement where they agree an action plan and we formalise that agreement. And it's that sort of approach or even an informal agreement that we would prefer to take wherever possible because it avoids that sort of compliance culture, it avoids significant costs and generally it will get the result for us. So that sort of sets out the range of from the sort of 2-3 year investigation. I'm not sure if you saw in the press. We've only ever done one investigation before, which was into Glasgow City Council. We've now started a new investigation. It was in the press on Monday, and it's into the Met, police, and that is again looking at sort of quite systemic and systematic discrimination issues around race and sexual orientation, bullying, and harassment. So that's the second time we've used that particular power. So we have to balance, really, the powers that we use. And I know there is an appeal to be seen to be taking people to court, and then that would show us using our teeth. But actually, we do use our teeth in a range of different ways, which we think are more proportionate and a more effective way of achieving what we want to achieve. Anything to add, Chris?
Just to say, we have launched a consultation on the strategic our approach to strategic litigation, and that's just commenced in the last few days. So it's an open invitation to the legal profession, people with an interest in equality and human rights, and anyone else, any other body, to help input to shape the future strategy. I think maybe just one observation on the approach in legal, as I know from many years working on these issues in Scotland, that there's a tendency when we approach organisations with issues or complaints that they will say, well, what can we do? Where do we go now? How do we improve this? So we generally meet with a reasonably positive response, and the approach to regulation that we take is a proportionate one. So where there's an opportunity to move issues along without having to take a formal legal approach, then we will do that. We will seek to address the issues in the most reasonable way. Obviously, if there is a point of law or if the behaviour of the organisation is so flagrant, then we would take action in those circumstances. But there is a general presumption towards trying to resolve rather than get into a litigation situation.
Thanks, convener.
Thank you. I think Alex, do you want to come in on this as well?
There was a couple of little issues I wanted to cover that add on to this. First of all, you talked a few moments ago at some length about equality outcomes, and a note in a letter that we received from you in May of this year that you've now agreed a national improvement approach with the Scottish Government and other stakeholders to improve the quality of equality outcomes. Are we essentially talking about the same thing there?
Yes.
Yeah. The The only other thing I was really interested to know is when, on the subject of enforcement powers, you said, as everybody would always do when we raise the subject of enforcement powers, that you want to work in a partnership arrangement, take it forward, and that sort of thing. Have you used the enforcement powers, and do you envisage that the enforcement powers will have to be used and used more as you go forward?
I think some of the examples I've already given, which are around things like undertaking inquiries or intervening in specific cases, serving compliance notices. So Chris will correct me if I'm wrong here, but in terms of getting public sector bodies to reply and to fulfil their requirements under the public sector equality duty, it was a compliance notice that was sent out. So we use the range of powers on a regular basis, to be honest. So the answer is yes, we use our enforcement powers. Do we foresee using them more in the future? I'm not entirely sure. I mean, I suppose that would depend on if there is a significant increase in discriminatory practice by any bodies. We have to work within our resources, and that's always a challenge, which is why we have to work strategically, and we have a sort of fairly detailed decision-making process in place, both in Scotland around public sector duty practice. So we've got a public sector duty panel. Any complaints or any issues that are raised with us will go to our public sector duty panel, where we'll assess whether it's strategic, whether it's going to test out the case law, whether we think it will impact on a significant amount of people, whether we believe it's truly a breach of the public sector duty, before we'll take action. We also have, at a GB level, a regulatory decision-making process, which is where we really allocate our legal funds, because obviously some of the ways in which we can intervene will require significant cost, but we believe will be worthwhile. So, for instance, the investigation into the Met's behaviour, we believe will have ramifications for other police forces as well, and that would be part of our decision-making. It's not just about, do we think that one agency is at fault? Do we believe this is going to change the face, in this case, of employment practice in institutions?
Thank you.
Siobhan would like to come in.
Thank you. You mentioned our reports as one part of enforcement. So I'm just wondering, because it seems quite odd to do a report as an enforcement practice unless something was coming at the end of it that demonstrated from there the key action you would be taking on that individual, that body, that sector. So out of those reports, what enforcement action has been taken other than to have a report into an issue?
We would rarely have a report without recommendations. And we would then work with whichever public bodies were named in those recommendations to take that forward. I'm not sure whether are there any specific examples you can pick up on, Chris?
I'm not quite clear about the question in terms of which reports are you referring to?
Well, in evidence, 3 times reports have been mentioned as enforcement, so I would have thought if you're using that as an example, you'd be able to tell the committee how that report has then gone on to mean that enforcement action has been taken, other than to investigate and people read. I mean, we're all capable of having a report into an action to read it, and then it goes into the long grass and nothing's done. So what action has actually been taken? If it's enforcement action, and the word is enforcement, that keeps coming up, that is a power that you're using the report to enforce something, what has been enforced?
If we take perhaps the work that we did on the outcomes as an example, we have issued reports on 3 different reports on assessing the performance of the around the duties. So that was essentially an analytical report. From that, we identified 27 bodies who weren't compliant, for we took action at that point. We then identified a further 45 bodies in terms of the outcomes where we felt that further work was needed. So it's a graduated approach in that sense.
Have you got another?
I suppose our human trafficking inquiry and our disability harassment inquiry have both led to some significant changes in practice across different agencies. So, for instance, the human trafficking inquiry has led to much improved multi-agency working across a range of services, including police, the Crown Office. So that was one of the recommendations. I wouldn't say a report is an enforcement action. A report may come out of an aspect of enforcement action, like an inquiry or an assessment, but they would never be considered enforcement action on their own.
And do you review those? Because obviously the human trafficking thing, I mean, that was something that was picked up in the media. People are very aware of it now. But to say the work has been done, and I'm sure it has been done, and things have changed, will that then be reviewed to show this is what we were looking for, this is the timescale we were looking for, and this is what has been achieved in that timescale?
Yeah, we're in year 3 of dedicating resource to the human trafficking inquiry work. We're in year 4 of dedicating resource to the disability harassment inquiry work. So we don't stop after producing reports. We have staff from the Commission sit on the government-led human trafficking task group, and our job there is to hold government to account to deliver what they said they would deliver as much as possible. We're working with the build team around human trafficking to ensure as much as possible the recommendations are built into the human trafficking bill. So we don't produce reports and stop our work there. It is challenging because a lot of the issues that we're trying to address are widespread systemic aspects of discrimination, and we do have to at some point stop our focus in one area and turn our attention to other more pressing issues. But I think the human trafficking and disability harassment are both examples of where we've continued to invest resource because we do believe that they're important areas, significant human rights and discrimination issues that we need to continue to invest energy in.
So I understand that you'll have people working with the Scottish Government and various other aspects and bodies, public bodies, but will there be more reviews published so that, you know, the general public can see what's going on, because obviously they're not involved in everything that you're doing, yeah, and know that you're doing. So you've published a report, as you said, you're in year 3 of one, year 4 of another. Yeah. For the general public, they won't know that. They won't know how those recommendations have been taken forward. So are those things published for them in a fashion that they would understand?
Yeah, our EHRC Scotland Annual Review, what we try and do here is highlight the wide range of work, and hopefully you'll have received a copy of this. That covers all our key areas of work. I mean, it covers transfer of expertise, our work around human trafficking, our work around disability harassment. And we explicitly set out here the impact, what we set out to do, what we did, and what impact we believe we have had, and the role that we've taken in relation to all these issues. So that's published every year as a high-level report of the work that we've done and we're investing our resources. And it also sets out the work for the year ahead.
That it will show what you have done, but what I'm asking is the impact across communities about what you have said has gone wrong, because you're saying enforcement. So a report has been taken, if that's enforcement, because something is badly going wrong, be that human trafficking, be that disability, be it the local authorities, whatever that may be, something has gone wrong. People are interested in it. Yeah. And what you're saying is, obviously, you continue to work in that. I'm not suggesting that you wouldn't do that. But then in your annual report, you'll focus on what you've been able to achieve and how that's been taken forward, and not necessarily how the recommendations have been met or not met in the timescale that's given. So again, will you publish something like that, or do you?
Well, we publish a range of information. Sometimes it's for us too, other times it's not for us too. And as I said earlier, quite a bit of the work that we do is confidential, so it's not for us to publish. We might encourage other agencies, if we're working with them, to let people know what they're doing. And it may not be for us to do that. So it depends on the individual case that we're working on, to be honest. So again, our work around public sector equality duty, we produce these reports, and we'll continue to produce reports about the work that we're doing and the improvements that we've seen in relation to the work of the public sector, which is one of the reasons that we're doing an evaluation at the end of this year of that particular piece of work. And these reports are all available on our website. So the answer is, it depends on the issue. Whenever possible, yes, we will be able to let people know what we've been doing, what impact that's had for individuals, for communities, and for agencies.
Can I just go back to that and ask a question? It might seem quite a very basic question, but say we've got a local authority who are not collecting the data and information you require, say for disabilities and race, etc. I'm assuming you go in and you work with them. Do they have timescales to actually achieve the criteria that you're looking for, or do you just go in and speak to them and say, you know, you're not achieving this, this is what we'd like you to do, and then walk away? Or are they given actual deadlines and sort of an action plan that they've got to complete for you to revisit them again and monitor them?
Yeah, we would never enter into an agreement without clear timelines and clear expectations about what we would expect. And by far, the vast majority of time, as Chris has already said, people are actually, it is rarely, if never, a case of people not wanting to do the right thing. It's often, it hasn't been prioritised in an agency, or they don't have the skills or the resource, and we can help with some of that. So we would, we would never just sort of go in and have a friendly chat and walk away.
So what you're saying is you would leave them with a development plan that you would monitor and review on a regular basis then?
If it's a formal agreement, then we would expect an action plan to be delivered to us within a set amount of time, which we would review and decide whether we felt that was satisfactory and it would achieve what we felt was compliant. And we would then, if that action plan wasn't delivered in time, we would then consider the next part of enforcement action.
And what could you explain? Say they decided we really don't have time to do it, it's not a priority, and they kept putting you off and not achieve what was set in the action plan. What would you actually have the power to do?
I mean, ultimately, we could take them to court for a breach of law, ultimately.
But you'd obviously hope to work through that process first and get agreement and cooperation first.
Yeah, it's not in anyone's interest.
Yeah, when you come.
Just on the back of that, how many times have you taken someone to court for not complying with an agreement that you've made?
Are you talking about a public authority?
Yeah, just in the example, as the convener has said, if they're not complying, how many times have you taken
In them? Scotland, we've never taken a public authority to court. We've never had to.
And have they always actually achieved the agreed objective that you've set out with them within their action plan?
To the best of my knowledge, yes. They have delivered what was required of them at the time. The work that we're doing now in the public sector equality duty, we're obviously having to invest quite a lot of time, energy and resource in trying to seek progressive and measurable improvement, particularly around areas like employment monitoring.
Do you find, because the reduction in staff and funding, you find that is maybe not one of your top priorities, or are you having to reprioritise this workload because of the lack of resources?
If we had more resources, there's more that we would do, without a doubt. And every agency, every public body would say that in Scotland and across the land. We have had to change the way that we work, and in part, I think the change in the way that we work is a bit more resource intensive. So there are probably things that we might have wanted to do which might have been more proactive in the past or more promotional in the past. We have had to dedicate. It's much more an improvement model. So we look at sort of improvement and use our regulatory powers where necessary, and also encourage best practice and the development of evidence to share across public bodies. So we've had, without a doubt, we've had to change the way that we work. Our focus remains on our statutory functions, one of which is on public sector performance.
Okay.
And certainly in terms of my role, in terms of heading policy, where a lot of that work in terms of public sector duty is located, it is the top priority. And if we had to, for resource reasons, stop working in some areas, that is the area that we would always preserve.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else get any questions on the back of this subject? No. Can I move on now to John Finney, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I would like to ask questions about the business plan, which you alluded to in your letter of 29th of May. And 3 points from there, if I may. The first one is about the engagement with businesses across Scotland to promote employer guidance. How's that gone? How is it going? And how would you tackle resistance? People might perceive that you'd get a more listening ear from the public sector than perhaps from private employers.
We partly because of the sort of reallocation of resources in our staffing in Scotland, we we hadn't had much engagement with the private sector, probably not since the days of the Disability Rights Commission and others. We made, and the Scotland Committee made a conscious decision to work to re-engage with the sector at the end of last year. And we undertook a range of activity with, it was Glasgow Chambers, who we worked with. We basically put out a contract for someone who already works in this sphere to work with us, for us to test out different approaches, some of which were successful and some weren't. I mean, it's an area that is very different for us. It's not, as you say, it's not like we have a private sector duty with which we can work. I'd say some of the more successful approaches that we've taken have been to develop case studies around employment law and film those and make them into resources. That certainly seemed quite popular. And holding a range of legal transfer of expertise type events with primarily HR employees from private sector firms. We're particularly keen to look at how we engage going forward with small, medium-sized enterprises, given the sheer number of them in the country and how many people they employ. We'll continue to work to deliver some guidance, advice and support through transfer of expertise events that run throughout the year. But the other area of focus that probably has been more successful has been our sort of thematic approach. So work particularly around the cleaning sector, looking at vulnerable workers, which has been a GB piece of work we've taken forward in Scotland. I'm going to let Chris say a little bit about work we're now doing to transfer learning from our previous meat processing work over into the fishing industry, and our colleagues from the North East might be interested in that particular work. And two other large-scale pieces of work, one which is looking at clarifying the law around religion or belief in the workplace. We think on the back of various cases last year, there is still a lack of certainty about what the law allows and doesn't allow around religion belief in the workplace. So we're doing a significant piece of work engaging across GB with employers and with service providers and with those who receive services who've experienced discrimination or have questions about religion or belief. Another major piece of work is around pregnancy and maternity discrimination. It's been some 10 years or so since the Equal Opportunities Commission undertook a large-scale survey into the scope of pregnancy and maternity discrimination. We're following that up now with detailed survey work across Britain, and that will also include Scotland, looking at both employers' perspectives and employees' experiences around pregnancy and maternity discrimination. So our work in the private sector is challenging, without a doubt. We've come across, you know, we haven't found it easy to gain a lot of interest, and we are going to continue to look at different approaches. We're always open to new approaches about how we can tap into that sector. But our sort of thematic work, certainly because they're areas where employers across both public and private sector have expressed concern or interest in issues like religion or belief, we expect to have more buy-in. Chris, do you want to say any more about private sector work?
I think Alistair's described a lot of the work. Like every organisation or regulator, we have difficulty in engaging with SMEs. It's not a secret. Everybody, I think, has that difficulty. So we're trying to find ways of getting in. We tend to get contact from SMEs at the last point, where something has gone wrong, and that's where we try and engage with them, or that's where they want to engage with us. What we're trying to do is to continually turn that round and say, these are the basics that you have to know about. This is how it works. We're happy to work in support sectors. But it is always a challenge, and I'm not going to make any bones about that. Specifically on the fishing industry, fish processing industry, which Alistair mentioned, this is something where we did a large inquiry where we had grounds for belief of discrimination, particularly around London in the meat processing industry, particularly about the employment of migrant labour and the terms and conditions of that. We've had some discussions with the STUC. There is an interest in particularly the fish processing industry. We don't have the same grounds for belief, I have to stress, that we had for the work in London, but we want to have a look at the
the sector. It is, again, particularly migrant labour and women concentrated in the industry, at the sharp end of the industry. And we want to take the learning that we've had from the meat processing industry, seeing as it's a very similar type of industry and a similar employee profile, and try and prevent problems rather than simply respond to them through litigation.
I'm presuming you'll engage with trade bodies and the like. Do you also involve the trade union movement?
This is a very early stage, I have to stress. Right. So we are working with the trade union movement just now. With we're just about to start to talk to the migrant groups. Once we've got that sorted out, we will then obviously engage with the bodies themselves, the employers themselves.
Okay, thanks very much on that. The Gypsy Traveller is an organisation you've had involvement in that in the past. And can you give us some idea of the timing and the research you're doing into site provision and how you envisage the findings may be used?
Please. This is a very long and ongoing issue. I've been involved in this for 20 years from an area of, from a race relations point of view, and now moving into the EHRC. And it's a situation that we're not seeing resolution to, and it's a situation which I think is predominantly about attitudes. We can take enforcement action. We have get very few cases coming through to us on that. But there's an attitudinal shift which needs to happen in Scotland about the provision of sites. A piece of work which we've commissioned this year, and we are just at the point now of publication. We just simply need to get the seminar set up to do this. It's looking at four areas, three in Scotland, one in Carlisle, which is close and similar enough for us to include it in. And it's looking at how continually when sites are proposed, there is public opposition, either through the press or through community councils or community organisations. We were interested in looking at sites where that type of heat wasn't generated. So we've identified three in Scotland, one in the north of England, where preparatory work was done, where we think a positive approach was taken to engaging with the community, both the Gypsy Traveller community and the settled community. We're just at the point of launching that just now. We will want to promote that particularly. At the moment, as you'll be aware, the Scottish Government has convened two or three groups looking at a national strategy for Gypsy Travellers, which we wholeheartedly support, and a specific group on housing, both of which I'm on. I think, like the committee, our sense is that until we get the site provision and accommodation issues, it will be very difficult to make significant progress on education, employment, life expectancy, or other forms of health. So it is a major issue for us. It's a complex issue in terms of responsibilities, in terms of legal responsibility. There is no legal responsibility, strictly speaking, on a local authority to provide a site. They have to assess need and they have to work towards meeting that need. One of the things which I'm particularly keen looking in at the moment in the housing group in Scotland is to review where we've got to. The guidance which has been provided by government has not resulted in new sites, and that's the fundamental issue. So we need to find ways of representing the issue. If we can learn from areas where good practice, where site provision has not been contentious, what is it about those areas, the approach of the elected members, the approach of the planning authority, what is it that they've been doing which is successful in stark contrast to some of the other parts of Scotland? I remember seeing you up in the site in Aberdeen, and the northeast we have virtually, it's a stalemate, it would seem. Similarly, on the west coast of around Glasgow, there is a significant lack of site provision. So we will use the research. It will feed into the government's group. It will feed into the strategy. We will promote it with local authorities. Again, one of the things that we're looking at doing is that making that link between successful authorities where planning applications are not seen as being contentious and trying to transfer that learning to those areas of Scotland where it is clearly contentious.
Yep. I could ask you a particular personal interest in this, and I could ask you questions all morning. This, I suspect the convener wouldn't allow that. But will these findings be shared with the committee? Because the committee's already been involved in two strands of inquiry involving the Gypsy Traveller community. That's the delivery of care and site provision. And I wonder if you'd comment on one aspect that I have a frustration that a number of local authorities keep their head down. So if they do nothing, they're fine. But if they do something and there's issues about that, then they can get a stick from various quarters. So if you were looking at a needs assessment, then the needs assessment, given that you've an itinerant community, can't stop at the boundaries of your local authority. There needs to be a broader approach taken. And I don't know if that's something that's been picked up along the way.
No, I completely agree. I think if you take an area like Eastern Midlothian, Eastern Midshire aside, that's absolutely fine, as far as I'm, as long as there is provision in relevant, you know, in an accessible and appropriate place. The fact that one authority doesn't have it in its space, I'm not particularly bothered about that. I think in the northeast, which is the particular area of interest for us, we need to, well, firstly, I think we need to have a regional approach to site provision, and it's a mixture of transit and permanent sites in public, private, or community ownership. So that's the backdrop that we need a national strategy. I think we also need regional approaches beneath that. So we would want to see far greater working between the authorities in the northeast. We had the Craigforth report some years ago, which was very helpful, extremely helpful in this issue, but we haven't seen any progress from that.
Okay, thanks. I have two further questions. Indeed, one of them has been answered, and it was about the legal aspects. The final one related to something you told us when you wrote in May, and that was the preparation you were making for the referendum on independence. Now, are you able to say, it said we will ensure proper thought is given to equality and human rights and effective post-referendum structures are in place during any transfer of powers to full independence or further devolution. I take it you are keeping a very active watching brief on implications.
Yeah, absolutely, both as a Scotland directorate and with the Scotland Committee, and also as a GB organisation with the GB board. We undertook two events leading up to the 18th. One was sort of probably more academic, looking at what the situation was in different countries in terms of equality and human rights. I suppose it was really looking at what's possible. And a roundtable event, more with NGO-type organisations to hear their thoughts and views. Our sort of starting point and our key principle is around no diminution from existing powers. We are now planning to host on the 2nd of October a further discussion, and we're going to bring that sort of whole range of people back together to hear where their thinking is at and what their views are, to help inform our thinking so that we can respond appropriately to any consultations around any further devolution. So we are keeping our eyes very firmly on the shifting landscape, as it were.
Okay, thank you. That's reassuring. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Marco Biagio.
Just as a follow-up to that one, I take it then that there is an intention to engage potentially with the Smith Commission any further mechanisms, because I'm aware of two equality organisations have already made representations to me and I think to other MSPs that they would be interested in further devolution of equality laws. Is that a fair interpretation of what you just said?
Well, that's what I think other organisations have said. I mean, our role will be to respond to any proposals rather than to be setting our own proposals, to be honest. As a regulator, our role is really just to sort of say this is how we think this may or may not impact on protection and promotion of equality and human rights. But that's what we want to be prepared for and to be sure that we are clear about what the range of stakeholders who will have an interest views are. And we've also had been approached in the last few days by various organisations, which is really helpful.
Well, excellent. The thing then I wanted to ask about was also, again, from the business plan, it was about the work on identity-based harassment in Scottish schools. Can you provide an update on where that is at the moment?
Where are we? I've just read the research report, the final version of the research report, so we're now preparing that for publication. That is really, really helpful. It's contains a literature review of basically everything that we know in terms of research and data that's been done, particularly in Scotland, but then also looking slightly elsewhere. And then two surveys which were done by the contractors, one with 1,200 pupils, and please forgive me, I'm not completely, and about and a very significant number of teachers as well. That report is, as I say, ready, just being prepared for publication now, so I'd hope it will be out in the next 6 weeks or so. What we're now moving to do, though, is to start to look at an intervention, and again, this is very much the improvement model that Alastair has been talking about, that we will invite schools, or a very small number of schools, to be fair, because we have limited capacity here. And we would want a typical school, not a school that is particularly bad or a school that is particularly good at dealing with this issue, but an average school, and to put a resource into them to help them to learn from the report, to look at the recommendations, which have also already come out from a number of agencies like Stonewall and Respect Me. So it's pulling all of that information together and testing an intervention in a school at the start of January, from January through to March, to evaluate that and then to be able to make a set of recommendations to other education authorities across Scotland about how we could start to improve practice. One of the issues which has continually come up in this work is that there is no requirement on schools or local authorities to actually collate and publish data about identity-based harassment. And that's an area which I think we will be wanting to pursue with the government going forward, because it is it's an anomaly, a strange anomaly, that we have a lot of police data which can tell us about the activities of school-aged children outside the school, but we have no comparable data about what's actually happening inside a school. And I find it, I would find it odd that there wasn't a read across between what happens just outside the school gate and what happens inside the school gate. So it's an area which I think we would want to pursue. It would help a lot of criminal justice agencies and a lot of the rehabilitative agencies to have that sort of data available about why, when, how these types of incidents are occurring, but particularly what can we do? What's the culture that we need to place in schools? What are the procedures and reporting mechanisms that we need to have to engage people's confidence, but to move towards reduction? Inevitably, in the way these things work, I would expect that as we introduce these programmes, reports of harassment will go up because people who are less confident will start to be more confident. That's a success measure. Perversely, over time, we would expect to see that go down.
The model you suggest for further action of having a pathfinder is very interesting. Going back almost to what Siobhan was saying about the follow-on from reports, I mean, do you envisage a substantial level of engagement then beyond that with, here is the example, and actively promoting that to different schools and local authorities? It strikes me that if there are almost 400 secondary schools in Scotland, as there are, that would stretch anyone's resources.
17 of us. I mean, I think it would be wrong to think that the EHRC is the sole arbiter and the sole body responsible for these types of things. The duties which we promote and that we are bound by are shared by the whole public sector in Scotland. We can set the measure, we can develop the resources, but for that to be effective, we have to find a way of that being mainstreamed inside education authorities. So we would be wanting to work with the government. Again, that kind of the issue about statistics and making sure that the government is collecting the right data, ensuring that local authorities are doing that. Yeah, we will work in partnership, but we are, to a certain extent, we've set the margin very much with the disability harassment inquiry and other areas. We've defined the issue. We've set out what good practice is. We've worked with some of the key strategic agencies, but the ball is now passed to them.
Yeah, I mean, but all these pieces of work will have a sort of to scale model. So it is very much about us being able to input our expertise and resource in one or two schools, testing what works, taking it to the next level, which might be 10 schools, and then moving up the way. And we've had a lot of support from the leading improvement team in Scottish Government, building on the model that's been used elsewhere, like the Scottish Patient Safety Programme. So it does have a wee bit of science behind it as well. And we're using the same model
working with Audit Scotland around audit and inspection activity. So we're currently working with Audit Scotland to look at court efficiency, which is one of their areas of inspection at the moment, to look at how you would effectively build equality and human rights considerations in there, look at the lessons learned, and then take that to the next piece of audit and inspection. And it's one way of trying to respond to the current climate. Thank you.
Can I pass you over now to Christian Allard?
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. I just wanted to go on three different patterns. The first one, we talked about it already, which was, of course, human trafficking. And I would like to explore maybe a bit more with the new laws coming in Scotland about human trafficking, how much you talked about year after year in the next 3 years will be more prioritised into the Scottish laws, or will you have a GB-wide agenda?
We're interested in the issue at GB level. There's obviously the Modern Slavery Bill in England and Wales and Human Trafficking Bill being developed in Scotland. So the human trafficking work we are dedicating some Scotland resource to. We have both a lawyer and our head of parliamentary affairs working with the trafficking group looking to develop that bill. We haven't looked into the work we're going to do next year on that, to be honest. So the resource that we've committed to is only up until the end of March this year. We'll work with the Scotland Committee to look at what resource we have available and what the priorities are for next year. So our key focus now is to make sure that the recommendations from the inquiry and the issues that we've picked up and follow up a year on and the year on report are built in as much as possible into the Human Trafficking Bill in Scotland.
Okay, and regarding enforcement, to come back to the point of enforcement, again, do you think the enforcement is more at a GB role and not, you haven't got that kind of autonomy to have a different level of enforcement, but it is a GB level?
We've got a GB level litigation strategy, which sets out some of the priorities and the ways that we work, but we have a dedicated legal team in Scotland. And they have a significant level of autonomy to undertake enforcement work on Scotland priorities. So I wouldn't say that the lead there is GB. We've got a GB legal team. Scotland participate in that, but obviously we're working with a different legal system and legal structure. So we have a significant level of autonomy to undertake enforcement work in Scotland, as we decide upon. The key issue really is funding for cases. So if funding is required for legal cases, that then goes into a GB pot. Most of our funding is GB funding. So if we want to apply to intervene in cases, we would need to go through the process I described briefly earlier, which is the sort of regulatory decision-making process. And we'd be asking the same questions. Is this strategic? Will it test out case law? There might be an argument if case law has been tested out in England on the issue that it hasn't been tested out in Scotland. So that may well, in fact, that has recently swayed an argument for undertaking a piece of work in Scotland, which might not normally have gone through that filtering process.
It's again GB-led.
We're a GB organisation, yeah. But we do have a significant level of autonomy to decide what work we would undertake. And partly it depends on funding.
The question would have been if you had more autonomy, will you consider enforcement differently?
No, because the equality framework that we're working within is the same framework. So I'm satisfied with the approach that we currently take to enforcement in Scotland, regardless.
Another question, but totally different, on the modern apprenticeship programme, again something which is very much Scottish based. And what I would like to know is how do you monitor? Yeah, I know it's difficult to go on. We need to go under the skin of the data. We talked about that at community level, but we need to measure improvement as well on both sides, on the accessibility to the programme for young people with disability and for ethnic minorities, and also to reduce the extent of occupational segregation in all these programmes. So can you tell us a bit more about that?
This was a piece of work that initially was going to be GB, but Scotland took the lead on, and this is one of the benefits of the ways that we can work, as we can look at different themes or different areas of practice across GB. Chris has led on that piece of work, but we've been really pleased with the impact that that work's had, particularly on the Wood Report. And I'll let Chris say some of the work that we're now doing to monitor progress and improvements.
I mean, I think you've hit the nail on the head, and the issue with the monitoring apprenticeship programme is largely is access, but also monitoring. When we looked at this, we managed to get data about the amount of people by different characteristic who are in the current programme, and as you'll know, we found, as we would expect, as we expected, significant gender segregation, but also very low participation from ethnic minorities, but also particularly low participation from disabled people. The difficulty is that in Scotland there is no monitoring of applications for apprenticeships, so we don't know who's coming forward. And if you don't know who's coming forward, all you see is those people who have been successful. So one of the recommendations which we have been working on with Skills Development Scotland is to get that monitoring of applications in place, because if young women are not applying for engineering apprenticeships in any number, then that starts to explain. That's one diagnostic thing. Equally, if young women are applying for engineering apprenticeships but not getting them at a higher level than men, we need to know that, because there's something then wrong in that system. So there are three things that we're looking for. The first is the monitoring. As I say, we'll discuss that with the employability team and also with Skills Development Scotland, and we're moving forward on that. Targets. We think that there have been a lack of rigour or aspiration in the modern apprenticeships programme. It's been very successful in its own right, but in terms of equality, it has not been successful. So we want to see targets, not quotas, but targets being set, which start to focus resource and thinking on why is it that only 0.3% of apprenticeships are going to disabled people just now. We want to have progressive things. That's been recognised by Wood, by the Wood Commission, and we endorse the targets that the Wood Commission has started to set out. And then finally, the area which we're working on is about contracts, that we feel that it will be of benefit to actually state specifically in the contract between the funder, Skills Development Scotland, and the college or other providers of apprenticeship programmes, that there are particular targets in place which they have to meet, or they have to work towards. They're not quotas, they're targets. This has led us into a significant area of work around procurement as well, where we are now working with the Scottish Government to develop what we're calling a worked example of equality and human rights in action in procurement, so that we're not just looking in isolation at modern apprenticeships, but taking the learning from that work and taking it across all government contracts and local government contracts, the NHS, police, colleges. So we're hoping that this will be... there are things which can be asked. The research that we did, I think, indicated very clearly that there were improvements that could be made in contracting and in procurement, and it's an area that we really want to look very closely at in terms of improvement over time. It has a massive role to play in promoting equality in the private sector and also in communities.
Have you got a timetable for this work you're doing with Scottish?
I'm currently trying to... I mean, we have the group. I'm trying to get the group to meet. It's been a very difficult time in the last couple of months to get anybody to meet about things. We're hoping to meet next month to commence the work. We want to look at two or three live examples of procurement so we can actually influence something as it's going through. I anticipate that running through to the end of this financial year, possibly a little bit longer. It'll be written up. And again, the way that we've worked on procurement particularly is that we're working inside the Scottish Government's procurement journey. So rather than publishing standalone guidance, which may have the danger of sitting on a shelf, we're integrating all of that thinking into the mainstream procurement activity and advice that the government gives. And that gives us immediate access to some like 7,000 procurement professionals across Scotland.
Okay, and the last point I wanted to make, and I'm delighted to see that as a North East MSP that you recognise that Sir Ian Wood Commission, there are good things coming out of the North East. And when you talk, I worked myself in the fishing industry for 30 years, and I'm quite interested to know the assessment you made to decide that the meat example in London could be replicated in the North East of Scotland in the fishing industry. And particularly, John Finney, my colleague, asked a question about trade bodies. I would have thought that the first port of call would have been trade bodies. Did you do the same thing in London? Was it trade bodies you talked to? But first of all, onshore and offshore, we've got SFF offshore, we've got Seafood Scotland onshore, so there are trade bodies there who will be interested to have a strong dialogue with you. We talked about dialogue with local authorities. I think in the private sector, we should have the same type of dialogue.
Absolutely. It's a staged process. We're approaching this in a very different way from the meat processing inquiry in England. That was a formal investigation where we had strong grounds for belief that discrimination was occurring or difference of treatment was occurring. We don't have those. We don't have that evidence just now. It's an industry which has similarities in terms of its employee profile. At the moment, we are simply... It's an exploratory piece of work. It's not... we're not going into this with the assumption that the industry has discriminatory practices. We can't do that. What we want to do first is to speak to some of the employee representatives, either that being through unions or through migrant organisations, to get a sense of what they are hearing and what they think may be happening inside the industry. If that were, for example, to come back saying everything is absolutely fine in the industry, then that would affect our approach. We will be taking a round table approach on this, I have to stress. It's an area which we have only just started work on. It's very, very early days on this. So we have not got a full plan worked out for it at this point. We'll be more than happy to come back to you, either in writing or through other appearances, to keep you updated on the work.
Yeah, I'm very interesting about the engagement you have with the private sector and the engagement you've got with the public sector. You know, you talked about your engagement with local authorities, and I think out there in the private sector, people would like to have the same kind of engagement and not having enforcement first and then a discussion.
Absolutely. This is not an enforcement approach that we're taking. We have no evidence at this stage of discrimination. We've had a couple of cases, but we have a couple of cases from different industries all the time. It doesn't mean there's a significant issue. It's an industry which, by its profile, and particularly by its employee profile, suggests there may be vulnerabilities, but we're not walking into this with any assumptions.
To be honest, it's as much as anything, sharing good practice from elsewhere and seeing whether it's relevant and whether there may be some relevance if we can alter our guidance at all and share it with the industry to improve practice. So it's absolutely not about enforcement.
Can we take you back to the modern apprenticeship issue? Mark would like to ask a question, then I'd like to come in the back of it.
Yes, you had referred earlier to the difficulty of collecting data on sexual orientation and faith. In all of our examination of modern apprenticeships, those two haven't really come up yet. And I wonder, does that reflect that the data isn't being collected, or does it reflect something else? Are those two strands being looked at with regard to modern apprenticeships, and any early conclusions?
I'm struggling now to remember all of the tables that were produced by the... From memory, and I really would have to come back to you on this, the data is being asked for across the protected characteristics. Part of the problem was that data wasn't being collated. Some of it was because of very, very low numbers. And so, again, one of the areas that we would want to look at with particularly in terms of the setting of the monitoring and the setting of targets, is how do we get better data on those areas? At the moment, we have really quite glaring findings about race, disability and gender, which give us enough to be getting on with. But absolutely, we would want to extend that monitoring to get better monitoring, or better monitoring data back on those areas, again, to start to determine whether or not there are inequalities or imbalances in access for those other groups as well.
You mentioned you're looking at Skills Development Scotland training providers will be set targets to actually achieve the set targets for people with the various disabilities, religious, etc. How are train providers actually able to achieve these targets if it's actually the employers who actually provide the modern apprenticeships to the training providers? And most of the employers tend to be actually SMEs in the private sector. So it seems to me that the work that your organisation actually has to do is actually to go in and contact these organisations and raise the awareness so that then you actually do have the people that are disabled, ethnic backgrounds, females, etc., work in the industry, because train providers can only provide modern apprenticeship training to people that's employed with an employer. So I'm kind of putting the ball back in your court and saying you really need to raise that awareness with the employers so that then the train providers and Skills Development Scotland can actually achieve the criteria.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a very different situation from other parts of the UK where there is a direct access to apprenticeships. So we're very, very aware of that. That said, 0.3 of all apprenticeships go to disabled people. I don't think that that is representative of a young people in young disabled people's employment pattern. I accept that there may be, it may not be the 20%, which is the general figure that we look at because of the age, issues about disclosure. There are a number of issues there. So yes, it is dependent on that pipeline coming from employers. I still don't think that that the 0.3% is in any sense reflective of that. As to who should be doing this, absolutely. I mean, the Commission has a role to raise awareness, as we are doing generally across the board with employers, specifically around this. But again, as we've talked about in other areas, our job is very much to set the pace in this area. It's important that the agencies like Skills Development Scotland, the colleges, that they take the responsibility for this and that they take this forward, because this is their full-time, that's their purpose. Our job is to influence that and to ensure that the way that they are working promotes the greatest accessibility for all people. So we're working with them, we'll help them, we'll look at strategies, but we don't have the resource or the remit, frankly, to go in and do that detailed work with every employer.
And I suppose the conversations that we had with Sir Ian Wood as he undertook his piece of work were also about how we influence elsewhere. So working with agencies like Skills Development Scotland, meeting with Sir Ian Wood to share our findings and to work with his team to look at what possible recommendations there might be, leading to 13 of the 39 recommendations in the report focusing on aspects of equality and access, which then starts to tap into some of the upstream factors about expectations of school leavers and some of those other pipeline issues. So again, with limited resource, that's how we tend to try and target our expertise.
Thank you. And our final question is from Siobhan.
Thank you. I'm just wondering, firstly, obviously we've now got a Cabinet Secretary for Equality, so how many times have you met with Shona Robson since her appointment?
We've met once since her appointment.
Okay.
I go back to Chris's point, it's been quite a busy time to engage and meet, but we have had a discussion around the Gypsy Traveller work, for instance, and whether the Cabinet Secretary would be willing to work with us on launching that particular product.
That's useful to know. And how many times have you met with Rosanna Cunningham over the last 3 years, given that she's got responsibility for religion and still does, even though we have a Cabinet Secretary for Equalities?
We have met in a variety of platforms. I don't think directly one-to-one, but on in a range of discussions.
Thank you.
And certainly the office is in touch with us on issues as well. So
I imagine issues come up, but given that, you know, for instance, one piece of work has been the Offensive Behaviour and Threatening Communication Bill, where religion was a big part of that, to have a minister that's responsible solely for religion, you would have thought that she would be engaging one-to-one with the HRC, so it's just to get that information. You mentioned pay gap issues, Alastair, when you were talking about some of the things that have come up with discussions with Scottish Government officials. I'm just wondering how, given that you have spoke about that, how you're taking that forward, because as much as obviously having a discussion at that level, which is welcome, and I'm sure the committee will welcome that, it's about taking that forward and getting real progress on an issue that a lot of us are frustrated by. So is there anything concrete at the minute that you've set out that you wish to take forward with the Scottish Government?
Do you want to say anything about the national programme?
In terms of the public sector, there, again, we have problems with the way in which pay gaps have been identified and measured in the public sector is inconsistent, is wildly inconsistent at the moment. And one of the things which really is part of the programme of work that we're doing with the government, one of the particular areas of that is around the pay gap and payback calculations. As I say, there is a variety of different ways which are being adopted by public bodies. Working with the government and Close the Gap, what we want to do is, again, to understand why there is this variety of ways being taken forward and to start to recommend particular approaches for particular sectors. So that we can get more uniformity across that area. We're just in the process just now of finalising that project with the government. Met with them yesterday, as Alastair said. We're further discussing that. Close the Gap we hope will be engaged to lead that work forward and to come up with a set of proposals which we can then put in place from the start of next year in terms of, again, that improvement work of identifying those public bodies who are doing it well and who we can be confident about their calculations and transferring that learning and knowledge to those organisations who are struggling at the moment. It's very difficult to make any comparison across or between sectors just now about equal pay performance because of that variety of different ways which have been employed. The Commission can't... we can recommend ways of doing it, but there is not an enforceable area. What the Scottish Specific Duty says is that data has to be produced. It doesn't say how that data is produced.
Just add a GB level. I mean, this is an issue that the Commission is interested in across the piece, and we are looking at a fairly significant programme of work starting specifically on pay gap next year, working up the details of that to make sure that it aligns with the Scotland Specific Duties, which are obviously different from specific duties in England and in Wales. So we expect to be putting more and more focus on this issue.
The committee informed of the work that you're doing on that, because I think that would be very interesting for us all to be. Thank
you. In fact, the initial proposals are in draft, so if it would be helpful to see as soon as they're available to circulate more widely, we'd welcome people's contributions and thoughts.
That would be great. Thank you. A phrase that's come up, and it was in the business plan as well, transfer our expertise or transfer the knowledge that's come up. Lots. I'm just wondering, has the EHRC carried out a skills audit of its own staff, given that obviously, I'm sure you don't profess to be the expert group on everything. So have you carried a skills audit of your 17 staff and transfer that knowledge between groups who wish to work with you?
I'm not entirely sure whether we've done. I don't think we've done a sort of formal skills audit. We have when we were looking to recruit our last set of Scotland committee members. We did a bit of a skills audit across the organisation and the existing committee to identify areas where we felt we didn't have so much expertise, and we used that information to target recruitment for Scotland committee members. The transfer of expertise programme is quite a sort of specific piece of work which goes out to inform, and we've done one specific event with third sector, for instance. So we have tried to target the transfer of expertise programme not just at lawyers or advice givers, but also to the third sector to understand the scope of the public sector duty and how it can be used to influence change, not just in courts but through a range of mechanisms. I don't think that quite answers your question, though. But we do try and use our intelligence from. We get information and requests in from a wide range of audiences to go off and speak. We regularly, on a quarterly basis, we assess who is asking us for information, who's asking for us to go and speak or to contribute to working groups to make sure that we are covering the range of protected characteristics and human rights which span our remit. And if there are any gaps, we would then try and address that, go off and speak to different groups to find out whether there's anything particularly we could do to help. So we do a range of things to try and match up what we do, what we know, with what people want and what they're asking us for. And that also helps to inform our business planning process.
It would be helpful maybe if you could maybe undertake the skills audit in a formal capacity, in that obviously you've done a report into what powers, and obviously you looked at independence, but further devolution will mean you're taking part in the groups that are there. Obviously a lot of us have been on this train asking for more powers and devolution anyway, but we need to know where you're at the minute to be able to establish where we want to go. So as a formal process, I think that would be helpful to the committee and for others to look into, if you could. Just finally, on the guidance and lots of guidance that you've published, a lot of voluntary organisations in particular have raised concerns with us that they might not be included in that guidance, that as much as you say you're an open and transparent organisation, that they might not be at the table when such guidance is formed. Is that something that you're looking at to include voluntary organisations in particular, but those who have an interest in equalities and human rights, bring them to the table to issue guidance and not necessarily rely on your own organisation?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that in everything we do, we look at who the appropriate stakeholders are. So if we want to engage with business, then the appropriate stakeholders aren't necessarily voluntary sector organisations, it's probably trade bodies or others. So we do look at all the work that we do and work out who's best to sit around the table. I think that the piece of work that we're engaging in now with the Scottish Government, and as we've said already, we sort of had a follow-up discussion on this yesterday. The work is looking at issues like pay gap and Bridge the Gap, who are an NGO organisation, around the table on that. So I do think we target our engagement appropriately. We also have a role in statute to undertake the development of various pieces of support and guidance. And at times that it will be appropriate to get others' views, and at other times it won't. To inform our approach around constitutional reform, we've had very wide-reaching engagement with everyone from inclusion to Stonewall and others. So I'm satisfied that we have a robust enough stakeholder engagement programme in place to respond to as you can see from our business plan and our annual review, the really wide scope and range of activity we undertake. I would love to be able to do more, but we have to focus our attention and our resources where we can.
If I could maybe just add to that, I think it depends very much on the nature of the guidance. Some things like codes, they have a very specific legal function and they have a particular purpose. Other areas, and just thinking of two pieces of guidance that we issued recently, one about Sikh articles of faith, absolutely Sikh community was completely involved in that. It would be nonsense not to have involved them in it. Procurement, it's a much more abstract area, the link between equality and procurement, and there are very few people in Scotland who have that knowledge. So we're the audience for the procurement guidance is very clearly the procurement professionals.
Would trade unions be part of that then?
Or
procurement and procurement, just because you mentioned procurement, did you engage in trade unions, SDUC, on procurement?
I would have to go back and look at it, to be honest. It was a member of my team did it, but I wasn't directly involved in it myself, but I'm happy to come back to you on that.
I think another important point is that part of our role is to ensure that public authorities, in meeting their duties, engage appropriately with organisations in their communities, and that's where we think, again, we can add value in terms of different voices contributing to improving services.
Okay, yep. Thank you both very much for coming along and passing on the information and answering our questions. That actually concludes today's meeting, and our next meeting will actually take place on Thursday, the 2nd of October. Thank you very much.